Hello and welcome to DigSketch, a channel dedicated to digital sketching for architects. So today I'll be going over some of the tools and techniques that I use on a regular basis and how they come together in drawing. The example I'll be sharing today is a diagrammatic section indicating key structural and MEP zones, minimum height clearances, and other critical dimensions. It's a good example of simplifying a lot of technical information at an early stage of the project. So today I'll be covering drawing setup, going over grids, paper sizes, line work, from sketching to hard lines, coloring, hatching, and a quick overview of layers and masks. So I'll just be touching on these points, but really each of them could be a video all on their own. So I'll definitely dig deeper into each of them in future videos. So first up, I set up my background grid. For this drawing, I wanted a scale of 1 to 100. And this drawing is on A3 at 300 dpi, which comes out to 4961 by 3508 pixels. Keep in mind, the bigger the drawing and the higher the resolution, the less layers you get in ProCreate. So often I'll go down to 200 dpi as well for when I need more layers. So for this drawing, I set up the grid spacing at 10 millimeters. So that on my drawing, each square of the grid would be 1 meter by 1 meter at 1 to 100. With a scaled background in place, I then laid out all my critical dimensions. In this section, it was the floor levels. Then I loosely blocked out the major lines. I typically use a pencil here. It's still pretty rough at this stage. And as I think through what information needs to be in the drawing, I'll just make notes to myself, as this is more like a first draft. And later on, I'll go over everything again with a pen. And one of the greatest things about digital sketching is you can sketch something off to the side on a new layer using the grid to get the right dimensions, and then just move it into the right place and merge it back into your drawing with the rest of your lines. I do that all the time. So you can see it's all drawn to scale, but if you do need more accuracy, it's easy to just tighten up your grid spacing. Next, I pick some line weights and start tracing over my sketch lines with hard lines. I covered how to quickly toggle hard lines on and off in a previous video. See the link below. Here I'm using the technical pen. I have my own presets set up for thin, medium, and thick lines. And with all the key lines blocked in, now I can add in some details. Add some shadows. It's easy to just drag a color into a shape. You can quickly fill shapes if you have it enclosed already. For entourage, like these cars, you can quickly copy and paste. I've set up a shortcut here for this using the quick menu button. And it's just a simple pinch to combine layers. You can also swipe left on a layer to duplicate it. As you get used to the interface, you'll find it faster to just switch between using your fingers and the Apple Pencil, sometimes using both hands as well. And here I'll just throw in some people for scale. I've lightly sketched them in roughly at 1.5 meters tall and use a thinner pen for more details to indicate some texture and materials. And as I start inking in the text and dimensions, the great thing is it's all erasable. I keep them on a separate layer so that I can always go back and edit them, move them around, or duplicate them as required. And you can see my loose sketches and notes still there in the background. It's easy to just turn them off or delete that layer, but I don't mind keeping them just for future reference. I may do a separate video just on text, callouts, and techniques on how to annotate your sketches. There are just so many benefits to doing this digitally over traditional media. But for the young architects out there, I would highly recommend focusing on improving your fundamental writing skills. Practice it. Seek out good examples. Watch that 30 by 40 video on how to write like an architect. Often I'll just write out the text off to the side, not worrying about placement, then moving it to the right location once I can see how long the text is. That's just something you can't do with a sketchbook. Here I'm using a marker to indicate some wood siding. I'll give it a couple different shades of brown to convey slight variations in the tone of the wood. Then use a rectangular section tool to cut off what I don't need. And then I can just lighten it up by adjusting the opacity slightly. I can then take that same shape and copy it over to use it again and just distort it to fit another location. Now for layers, I always work with a ton of layers because it just makes it easier to go back and edit things. Especially for a drawing like this, which was part of the design process, just constantly going through iterations on a weekly basis. This is really one of the main reasons why ProCreate is my first choice, just the robust features around the layers, being able to easily merge, duplicate, and control opacity are just critical for me. And often I'll need to isolate certain layers so I can focus in on particular details. ProCreate just makes this so easy. One thing I love is the ability to group layers. This was a game changer when it was introduced. I do the same thing in Photoshop. Grouping just helps immensely for when you have a lot of layers like me. And I'll typically only name key layers or groups, but for a majority of them, I just don't feel it's necessary because you could always easily select the layer visually on the screen. To select a layer on screen, you can set up a shortcut gesture so that when you click on the quick menu and tap with the Apple Pencil, this brings up the layers right where you tap on the screen, and you could then select the one you want. And I'm not always super organized with my layers, so this is extremely helpful. And another good tip is isolating layers. You just hold down the little checkbox here, and this turns off all the other layers. You can now work on this layer and then hold that little box again to turn everything back on. I use this one all the time as well. I think I'll do a video just on layers in the future. There's much to cover on this subject. So there's a couple different ways to go about hatching. You can select an area, pick a brush, and just color it in. This is one of my own custom-made hatches. Another way to go about it is to just brush in generally over some of the areas and then use a rectangular section tool to select all the areas you want to keep. Then just tap on the layer and click mask. This makes it easy to go back and edit the base layer later on. So with a drawing like this, there are a lot of layers, a lot of complex information, and our job is to simplify things as much as possible. So it's easily understandable by multiple parties. Each line has its own purpose. And the beauty of doing these types of drawings digitally makes it easy to go back and change things as required. Design is an iterative process, and this particular drawing went through many iterations in consultant workshops and client review meetings. So I hope you found this video helpful, and as always, like and subscribe for future updates, and I'll see you in the next video.